American Forces Network Europe presents... Countdown 25. A silver replay of the best of AFN's 25 years on the air. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Countdown 25, a special series devoted to recalling the sounds of the past quarter century, the sounds of music, the sounds of comedy, the sounds of drama and of history, the sounds broadcast to Europe by AFN Europe these past 25 years. Tonight, another year from AFN's Sound Scrapbook.
This evening, we recall the year that began for AFN on the 4th of July in 1955.
I have decided that if the Republican Party chooses to renominate me, I shall accept that nomination. Thereafter, if the people of this country should elect me, I shall continue to serve them in the office I now hold.
As AFN entered its 13th year on the air, Dwight David Eisenhower let it be known that he was ready to spend another 4 years in the White House, and AFN carried his words to Europe. For AFN was a primary force in implementing the President's People-to-People program, broadcasting not only the words of our country's chief executive, but the music of that country. In 1955, one of the most popular pieces of music played by the network disc jockeys was the theme from the immensely successful Walt Disney series, Davy Crockett.
Born on a mountaintop in Tennessee, greenest state in the land of the free, raised in the woods so's he knew every tree, killed him a bar when he was only three. Davy, Davy Crockett, king of the wild frontier, fought single-handed through the Indian War, till the Creeks was whipped and the peace was in store. While he was handling this risky chore, made himself a legend forevermore. Davy, Davy Crockett, the man who don't know fear.
He went off to Congress and served a spell, fixing up the government and laws as well. He took over Washington, so I hear the tale, and patched up a crack in the Liberty Bell.
Davy, Davy Crockett, seeing his duty clear. When he come home, his politicking done, while the Western March had just begun. So he packed his gear and his trusty gun, and lit out grinning to follow the sun.
Davy, Davy Crockett, leading a pioneer.
He heard of Houston and Austin and Seoul,
to the Texas plains he just had to go.
Their freedom was a fighting another foe,
and they needed him at the Alamo. Davy, Davy Crockett, king of the wild frontier.
One of the most popular AFN shows in 1955 was the Red Skelton program. Here's a segment from one in which Red plays both himself and his famous character, Dead-Eye Dick.
How about that crowing horse?
Well, here's Dead-Eye's ranch.
Yeah, it's a typical California ranch. It's so small that the chickens have to lay their eggs standing on end.
Don't move around. You'll get that one on your feet.
I'll go see if I can find Dead-Eye.
Yeah. Hey, you know, I must be awful anemic. A mosquito just bit me and then spit in my eye.
Hey, this looks like Dead-Eye riding up now.
Whoa! Whoa! Oh, come on, horse boy! You don't, whoa, I'm not going to let you take elocution lessons from Francis the Talking Mule anymore. Here. Oh. Here.
Are you all right, Deadeye?
Oh, sure. I always wear my ribs wrapped around my head this way. What's on your mind, Dud?
Dude?
This is a nice place you have here.
Oh, it ain't much. I call it home when the Bank of America ain't listening.
Nice horse you have there. Yeah. Is he smart?
Oh, he's almost as smart as me. He ain't got a brain in his head.
How old is that horse?
Well, the only way to tell a horse's age is by looking at his teeth. Take him out and look at him. Maybe you can tell.
Deadeye, how long have you been living in California?
Oh,
how do you like it?
I don't know. I'd rather be back in Texas, truthfully. But I'm worth $5,000 reward there.
Deadeye, you mean to say there's a $5,000 reward on your head?
No, just my body. My head's worthless.
Well, how do they want you, dead or alive?
What other ways are there?
Look, I just dropped by to ask if you'd make a personal appearance at the Skunk Patrol's benefit show.
Oh?
Junior wants to raise enough money to raise a flag over their clubhouse.
Well, I sure will. I'm mighty fond of children. Mighty fond. Mighty fond.
If there are any television sponsors listening in, I'm your boy.
I'm mighty fond of children. You see, my folks didn't have any children.
Well, then how did you get here? Well,
I'm sorry you asked, Ed. I don't have an answer right now. You just read your part. I'll do the ad-lib.
Well, I thought maybe you could do a few rope tricks and maybe sing a cowboy song.
Yeah, I've got a good arrangement of the cry of the wild goose. I take off my boots and dance around in my web feet. Here, I'll give you a sample of my singing. Oh, there's blood on the sail. There's blood on the ground. There's blood in the sand. Blood all around. Poodles of blood.
Ooh. You fainted. Hey, Deadeye, what happened?
I scared myself.
Well, I'll see you next Sunday, Deadeye.
Yeah.
I've got to go see Dave Rose about using his orchestra on the show.
Okay.
Another of America's favorite comedians died during AFN's 13th year on the air. His last appearance was on another show aired by AFN that year, What's My Line?
Fred Allen.
And at my left, ladies and gentlemen, the young lady whose house was broken into last Friday night and who wants to thank the robbers because even though they did take all of her jewelry and her money, they were kind enough to leave her air conditioning unit, Miss Arlene Francis.
Following the announcement of Fred Allen's death, the American Forces Network aired a special salute to the comedian, featuring the recollections of many of his friends and the comedy of Allen himself.
I had a room. It was so small, it had removable doorknobs. If you wanted to bend over in your room, you could take off the doorknob just in case. At Mrs. Brown's, when you took a bath, you had to keep singing. There was no lock on the bathroom door.
Fred was born John Florence Sullivan. In vaudeville, he was known variously as Paul Huckle, Fred St. James, and Freddie James. How he became known as Fred Allen is told by Benny Drone.
He was up in a booking office. A fellow by the name of Edgar Allen used to book the Fox circuit around New York, and he was looking for work, and the guy says, what do you do? He says, I juggle. He says, go right down to the 14th Street Theater, the Fox Theater down there, and get your stuff down there, and you'll be able to go on for the rest of the day, and it's a split week. You'll get the 3 days' pay. So after he left, the man at the theater called up and said, what's this fella's name he's sending down? Because we'd like to put his name out with the rest of the vaudeville bill in front of the theater. And this fella, Edgar Allen, said, his name is Edgar Allen. And the fella on the other side thought he said Fred Allen, so out went Fred Allen, And from then on, he was known as Fred Allen.
The camera starts, and we bring you the latest news of the week. The Town Hall News sees nothing, shows all. Atlantic City, New Jersey. New Jersey Mosquito Association protests reduction of mosquito extermination fund for 1935. Town Hall News sees summer business jeopardized by mosquitoes. Mrs. Belladonna, committee sister, aroused.
I was chairman of the committee last year, but when the mosquitoes got through with me, I couldn't use my chair all summer. The next mosquito stings me, I'm going to sting him right back in the same place, if possible.
Toward the end of each Town Hall Tonight show, Fred would feature some amateurs. It didn't matter much what their talent was. What made it so wonderful was Fred's ad-lib interviews with these people. It was one of these amateurs who was the cause of one of the classic feuds of show business.
Fred had a boy violinist on the show. He was 10 years old, and he played the B. And when he got through with the number, he said to him, he asked his boy, he said, "How old are you?" And the boy says, 10. He says, 10 years old, and you played the B so well. He says, "Jack Benny ought to be ashamed of himself." And that's all he said. And he probably said that knowing that I was listening to his show just to make me laugh. So on the next show, on my show, at the very tag of the show, the thing we call the tag, I said to Mary, and this was merely to make Fred laugh, I said, "Mary, take this. I'm going to dictate a message to Fred Allen. I want you to mail it for me. Say, 'Dear Fred, when I was 10 years old, I could play the B too.'" Well, the next week, Fred had some stooges on who were supposed to have known me in Waukegan, Illinois, to prove that I couldn't play the B when I was 10 years old. The following week on my show, I brought people on from Waukegan who said I could play the B when I was 10 years old. And before we knew it, we were into the darndest feud you have ever seen, which was very funny. And the strange part of it is, I can safely say from 6 to 8 months with this feud, before we even called each other on the phone about it.
Now, don't get excited. Look, if you're cheap, you're cheap. That's the way I look at it. Some people save asparagus ends. It's a hobby. My hobby is not spending. I hate to get these big laughs on your program.
Probably the most satisfying event to Fred in the whole wonderful feud was the night he stole Benny's britches.
Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute. An expert operating the Hoffman pressing machine will press your trousers.
Now, wait a minute.
King.
Alan, Mr. Frey, where are my pants?
Benny, for 15 years I've been waiting to catch you like
Alan,
this.
Alan, you haven't seen the end of me.
It won't be long now.
I want my pants.
The most popular song during AFN's 13th year on the air, and the one that took the Academy Award for 1955, was the title song from the motion picture Love is a Many Splendored Thing.
Love is a many splendored thing. It's the April rose that only grows in the early spring. Love is nature's way of giving a reason to be living. The golden crown that makes a man a king. Oh! and the world stood still. Then your fingers touched my silent heart and taught it how to sing.
One of the most creative ventures ever undertaken by the men and women of the American Forces Network was a series called Cool Man's Mother Goose, hep versions of classic nursery and fairy tales. On this program from the series, Rosemary Clooney's brother Nick Clooney, an AFNer in 1955, narrates the Cool Man's version of Goldilocks.
You should give great big ears to the story of Goldilocks and the Three Squares. These three squares, or bears, if you want to be zoological-like about it, padded down in a neat little prefab out in the woods. Why the woods, you ask? Well, they wanted to get away from it all. You know, those big city inconveniences like hot and cold running traffic, all-night delicatessens, subway tokens, 4 a.m. double features, and pitched battles in bargain basements. All these bears wanted, like, was peace and quiet. One day, it was a weekend, and Papa Bear didn't have to catch the bus for the Honey Works. The three bears are sitting around the dining nook waiting for their fresh-cooked ration of breakfast halva to cool down. Papa Bear, he puts down the financial section of the New York Times, and he says, like this, he says,
"Only honeybees. Hasn't that halva cooled off yet? Why, I am as hungry as a human."
And Mama Bear, who's been glimming the four-color ads in the New Yorker, answers him in this fashion, saying,
"George Bonham, Murgatroyd, Gruen, you watch till I was at the breakfast table. Besides, how could I help it if the halva tastes too off to cool? That's what I get for using these pre-mixed beef recipes."
And Baby Bear, sitting at the end of the table, oblivious to everything except his latest copy of Metronome, complains like this, saying,
"Weepers, the way you two types are noising about, a cat can't even register the sounds inside his own cranium-type head-like."
"Are you speaking English by any remote chance?"
"Now, George!"
"Of course I'm speaking the native tongue. What's with your dads anyway? Don't you dig like?"
"George, and you too, baby. Let's stop this quarreling. I have it. Let's go out for a walk in the woods."
"A walk in the woods? Ma, how icky can you get?"
"Icky," he says.
"I don't know what you're talking about, baby. My little walk would be fine. It'll give us an appetite."
"An appetite I already got."
"And allow the halva to cool off."
"Ma, did you say cool?"
"I did."
"Well, like, what are we standing around here yakking for? Let's drift. Woodwise, that is."
And with that, boys and girls, the three bears, they climb into their best threads and make with the toe bones in the general direction of the woods. Being as not too many types wander near the bear's pad, Papa Bruin, he leaves the front door unlatched, exposing all their time installment furniture to potential burglars like. While the three bears are off in the woods, picking violets and getting their feet stained with chlorophyll, who comes ankling down the old path but Goldilocks? I mean, like, you can tell right off it's Goldilocks because she's wearing her golden hair, which sparkles in the sun like a choker from Cartier's. Then, too, she's singing to herself in the following fashion. Yes, three boys and girls, this Goldilocks is one very cool chick indeed. And as I said before, she's laying down five on this path when all of a sudden, like, what does she see but the bungalow the three bears call home? Noting that the front door is open, Goldilocks, she pushes it open and speaks in the following manner like this, saying,
"Yoo-hoo! Hey, like, anyone home?" "Like I said, anyone in occupancy?" "Huh. Must be all out of the supermarket or something. What's that I smell? Can it be? Oh, no, it can't be. But it is. Halva, my very favorite breakfast food.
And with that boys and girls Goldilocks, she follows her nose to the dining nook where those three bowls of halva are cooling off. Grabbing a spoon, she digs into the big bowl, which, as you know, is the personal property of Papa Bear. After taking a spoonful, she says like this. She says...
Whoosh! Man, like, that halva's too hot. Here, let me try that medium bowl, Ephesize.
And Goldilocks, she drops her ivories into Mama Bear's bowl of halva. After a mouthful, though, she says this way. She says...
Yeah, banana-flavored halva. I'm hungry, but I'm not that famished. Here, I'll just try me a little of that small bowl down there at the end of the table.
And with that, boys and girls, she lunches into Baby Bear's bowl of halva. This, like, is the real McCoy, or should I say the real Turkish delight? Anyhow, Goldilocks, her eyes roll up into her head like a window shade with a tight spring. She pats her cute little tummy, and Goldilocks, she pitches into the Baby Bear's ration the way a Joe from Sands Point makes with a Nathan's Red Hot. I mean, like boys and girls Goldilocks, she demolishes that bowl of halva, but utterly. She's just picking the crumbs off the crumbs when she says like this. She says...
Mmm. Man, that was just right.
Like I said before, boys and girls, right is no word for it. Goldilocks, she just sits there, listening to her stomach make noises from all that halva. Pretty soon, though, she notices something in the corner of the room, and going over to Sherlock Holmes it, she says, all surprised, this way, she says...
Well, grow me a chin piece and call me dizzy. A hi-fi set yet?
Yes, sir, boys and girls, a little old hi-fi set complete with earphones and the Victor Beagle. Goldilocks, flipping through the waxings careless-like, chooses one that belongs to Papa Bear. Little does she know that it sounds like this.
I love your loving arms. They hold a
That's right, boys and girls. Goldilocks, she listens to four bars of that stuff, and all that halva she's been eating curdles like a bottle of grade A left out in the sun. Quick-like, she grabs another platter, this one being the property of Mama Bear, and gives ears to the following. Well, boys and girls, like, you know how it is with Dixieland. Goldilocks, she digs this bit no deeper than Papa Bear's, and to relieve the pain, spins in the following cut, which, by the by, is the property of Baby Bear.
Cool, man.
Indeed, very cool, man. Goldilocks, she dug this last thing but the most. In fact, she was so cooled by it that what must she do but play it again and again and again. But this time, as you might very well suspect, those three bears, they've gotten tired of tramping around in the dandelions, and they come back to the house. Proceeding to the living room in high dudgeon, from which they dismount when they enter, they spy all those waxings that Goldilocks has scattered about the premises. Papa Bear, he says this way, he says...
Hey, who smashed my Guy Lombardo?
And who's been playing my Killari?
Pupkis for that uncool noise. Where's my Sal Salvador?
Hey, like, dig the frail in my settee.
Oh, I'm like, it's just me, Goldilocks.
Goldilocks?
Goldilocks!
Say, like, is there an echo in here?
You mean like chick, you make it with a moniker, Goldilocks?
What else, little fur man? You like? You're the one that owns these Salvadors?
Nobody but me. You dig Goldilocks?
But, yes.
What do you say we junk this joint and make it to the big city together?
Lead on, Bruin. Lead on.
So, boys and girls, hand in hand, Goldilocks and Baby Bear, they drifted, leaving Papa and Mama Bear at the cottage in the woods with their mouths hanging open. Baby Bear, he and Goldilocks made it to the preacher together, and after he took a shave, they lived happily ever after. Which is the end, like, of the story of Goldilocks and the Three Squares. Kind of hope you dug it. Keep cool, will you?
You are listening to Countdown 25, a sound review of AFN's 13th year of broadcasting as the American Forces Network Europe approaches the conclusion of its 25th year on the air. From July 4th, 1955 to that same date in 1956, AFN's news team of writers, producers, and announcers were as busy as ever compiling, editing, and reporting the news of the world for American forces in Europe. That 12-month period began with a summit meeting in Geneva between the President of the United States, Dwight David Eisenhower, the Prime Minister of Great Britain, Anthony Eden, and the new chairman of the Presidium of the USSR, Nikita Khrushchev. The main subject of the meeting was the reunification of Germany. But little was accomplished in this direction, and a follow-up foreign ministers' meeting was held in the Swiss city in late October. An AFN newsman was on hand when John Foster Dulles arrived for the conference.
I am very glad to be again in the hospitable city of Geneva, which has for me so many happy memories. Its spirit, the spirit of Geneva, has become identified with the hopes of all the world. In that spirit, the four foreign ministers will meet and seek to carry out the directives which have been given them by the four heads of government when they met here in Geneva last July. Those directives, in the first instance, deal with the closely linked problem of the unification of Germany and European security. The United States delegation will seek, with necessary conciliation, to achieve the constructive elements of a just and durable peace sought by the earlier conference of the heads of government. Thank you.
An AFN microphone also greeted British Foreign Secretary Harold Macmillan in Geneva.
I am very glad to be back in Geneva to take up again the work which was started at the summit conference last May. I trust that the work that we shall do together will be fruitful in the cause of peace and in the settlement of the many difficult problems which beset Europe. We have a chance of doing a good work together, and I pray that under Providence we may succeed.
1 month earlier, the free world was shocked by an announcement from the White House, an announcement that President Eisenhower had suffered a mild coronary thrombosis, a heart attack. But less than 2 months later, the famous Eisenhower grin was back, and the chief executive looked hale and hearty as he spoke to newsmen on leaving the hospital.
Again, it is time for Mrs. Eisenhower and me to say goodbye to Denver after a summer's stay. This time we leave under somewhat unusual circumstances. As you know, I've spent a time in a hospital. Such a time is not wholly a loss. Misfortune, in particular, the misfortune of illness, brings to all of us an understanding of how good people are. To the General Griffin, the staff at Fitzsimmons, the medical staff, the nurses, the clinical technicians, enlisted men, all of the people that even clean out the hospital, my very grateful thanks, because they have done so much. Not only to take care of me, but to make my stay as pleasant as possible. They're devoted people. In the same way, here at this post, General Sprague and his staff have taken on an additional and extra load and have done it cheerfully and in a way to earn my eternal gratitude. Then Mrs. Eisenhower and I have both been touched with a volume of messages that have come in. Telegrams and letters and flowers and gifts. And finally, we've been especially grateful for the knowledge that over this country and over the world, friends have sent up their prayers for a sick person. So, I leave with my heart unusually filled with gratefulness to Denver, to the people here, to the locality, in fact, to everyone who's been so kind. And I hope that those people who sent in messages and Mrs. Eisenhower's not been able to reach them, and she did her best, that they will know that through this little talk, we are eternally thankful to them. Goodbye and good luck.
Autumn of 55 brought news that Juan de Perón, the president, the dictator of Argentina, had been overthrown.